بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه. I ask the Almighty God with all of His beautiful names and divine attributes that He makes us among those who listen to the words of wisdom and follow the best of it. Allahumma ameen. In the last session, we concluded with the ayah, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا لَا تَجْزِي نَفْسٌ عَنْ نَفْسٍ شَيْئًا وَلَا يُقْبَلُ مِنْهَا شَفَاعَةٌ وَلَا يُؤْخَذُ مِنْهَا عَدْلٌ وَلَا هُمْ يُنصَرُونَ. And fear a day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not accept from any of us except that which we have put forth in terms of the purity of aqeedah, the purity of the deeds that are consistent with the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No ransom will be taken from any soul, and then every soul will be reckoned according to that which it has put forth. Then after this reminder, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds the Israelites, and this is not specific to the Israelites. Yes, these ayat were revealed in the Israelites, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the best of stories in the Quran in order for us to follow the good aspects of it and to refrain from, you know, attaining or engaging in that which is considered to be shar, or to consider it to be evil, or consider it to be in violation of the Sharia. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds the Israelites by saying, وَإِذْ نَجَّيْنَاكُمْ مِنْ آلِ فِرْعَوْنَ يَسُومُونَكُمْ سُوَ الْعَذَابِ يُذَبِّحُونَ أَبْنَاءَكُمْ وَيَسْتَحْيُونَ نِسَاءَكُمْ وَفِي ذَلِكُمْ بَلَاءٌ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ عَظِيمٌ. And remember the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you are enslaved by the people of the Pharaoh. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, آل فرعون, because the Pharaoh was not the only one that was enslaved, you know, the Israelites, but rather the Pharaoh and his cabinet and everybody else who was under him. وَاِذْنَجَّيْنَاكُمْ مِنْ آلِ فِرْعَوْنَ. And remember the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He saved you from the people of the Pharaoh. Yes. I see. Can somebody lower the volume for the sister's side, please? وَإِذْ نَجَّيْنَاكُمْ مِنْ آلِ فِرْعَوْنَ يَسُومُونَكُمْ سُوءَ الْعَذَابِ يُذَبِّحُونَ أَبْنَاءَكُمْ. They slaughter your children. And the word abna, it means the male children. The word awlad in the Arabic language, it means girls and boys. Or it could mean either one. But the word ibn or abna, it means sons. And of course, the wisdom behind that, as the Pharaoh saw that in his sleep he saw a fire that rises from Bayt al-Maqdis, from Jerusalem, and that it has engulfed all of the homes of the Egyptians except the Israelites. So when he asked for an interpretation of this dream, he was told that a person, a male person from the Israelites, will rise and overtake his throne and his kingship, and will be the cause for the collapse of his kingship and the destruction of, you know, his kingdom. So as a result, he made a determination to slaughter every single newborn boy. So the cabinet of the Pharaoh, when he began to do that, they feared that after receiving all these services from the Israelites and their children and their women, they feared that they all are going to perish. And that's exactly what's going to happen when you slaughter all the male children, you know, of a particular people, that at a given point the old will die, and then there is no, you know, the cycle of life would stop. So they suggested that he slaughter the children 1 year and let them live another. Slaughter 1 year and let them live another. Harun alayhi salam was born in the year that the Pharaoh did not slaughter any children, and in the next year Moses, peace be unto him, Musa alayhi salam, was born. And we all know the story of Musa, and we'll come, inshallah, to explain the story of Musa in details later in Surah Taha and other surah, inshallah. And the word yudabbihuna, it's a method of killing, which is the slaughter. And in some narrations were reported that the tribulations have reached to such extent that a mother would behold in her new born baby boy, and the soldiers of the Pharaoh would walk into the home and would slaughter the neck of the boy in the lap of the mother and just leaving the body there. So you can imagine the cruelty of committing such an act to slaughter a baby in the, you know, in the mother's lap. يذبحون أبناءكم ويستحيون نساءكم. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, يستحيون means put to service. And the service is not just providing labor. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, نساءكم, meaning that the females among you, be it the daughters or the sisters or the wives or any of that. In other words, the people of the Pharaoh used to commit the fahisha. In addition to enslaving these women for service, they also used to put them to, you know, the services of adultery and fornication and things of that nature. And this is like the peak of tribulation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَفِي ذَلِكُمْ بَلَاءٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ عَظِيمٌ. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, in this, there is a bala. And bala means tribulation. Tribulation can be good and can be bad. It's good if one succeeds and oblige themselves to follow the Sharia in spite of the injustice or the injustices that are being caused to them. In spite of the injustice or the injustices that are being caused to them. In other words, it is not acceptable for a believer, because they've been caused injustice, to transgress over the Sharia and retaliate in ways that are not compliant with the Sharia. Then basically the sin now is equal between the perpetrator and the one who's been victimized, the victim. Okay? وَفِي ذَلِكُمْ بَلَاءٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ عَظِيمٌ. So this is a testimony from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that in this indeed there's a tremendous tribulation for you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِذْ فَرَقْنَا بِكُمُ الْبَحْرَ فَأَنْجَيْنَاكُمْ وَأَغْرَقْنَا آلَ فِرْعَوْنَ وَأَنْتُمْ تَنْظُرُونَ. فَرَقْنَا بِكُمُ الْبَحْرَ is that when Musa alayhi salam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded them to persevere in patience, and commanded Musa alayhi salam to leave with the Israelites with him. As reported, about 600,000 of them have left. And then of course, when they reached the shore, what did they say? They saw that the soldiers of the Pharaoh are after them. They could eyeball them, they could see them eye to eye. And it was reported that the Pharaoh had 1 million soldiers that were well equipped, while the Israelites were not. So those who looked at this scene, and could justifiably be so, قالوا إِنَّا لَمُدْرَكُونَ. Indeed, we've been overtaken, this is the end of us. Which makes perfect sense for one who does not think over the abilities and the infinite possibilities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about, to say, I'm done. إِنَّا لَمُدْرَكُونَ. But Musa alayhi salam is not just an ordinary person. Musa alayhi salam is a prophet, is one of the mighty messengers. His deep conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that even if the sword is on my neck and it's not destined for me to die, I'm not going to die. قَالَ كَلَّا. He immediately responds, كَلَّا إِنَّ مَعِيَ رَبِّي سَيَهْدِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with me and He will guide me for the next step. He commanded me to take the Israelites and cross the sea with them. So indeed He's going to facilitate that escape for me. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Musa alayhi salam to hit the sea with the stick, and by no stretch of the imagination the stick did anything. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He wants something to be, He simply creates a cause-effect type of relationship. Do this and this will happen. Do this and this will happen. In other words, do your part. And if all that you can do is just to take that stick and hit the sea with it, then that's what you do. If all that you can do is to shake the palm tree or to attempt to shake it, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause the days to fall on you. So do what you can. Musa alayhi salam would hit the sea with the stick. The sea will split into 12 different roads that are ready to be crossed. In other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused, be it by way of sending the wind or any other way, caused the floor of the sea to be dry and to be suitable for walking, because the Israelites left on foot. Then some of them began to ask Musa, what about our brothers? What about our families? Where are they? And of course, Musa alayhi salam supplicated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that openings like windows, if you will, in each mountain, that when the sea was split, it created mountains. Now what's holding this water? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What's making this opening within a mountain for them to be able to see the next group, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's nothing beyond Him. The rules of the universe, the rules of science, the rules of physics apply to us, but do not apply to the Creator. They do not apply to the Creator. So they were able to see, you know, what's going on. Then of course, what happens? The Pharaoh, by the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and his soldiers decided to follow. So imagine, somebody sees a miracle in front of them with their own eyes, that it is not Musa alayhi salam that did magic to make the sea split. It is not Musa alayhi salam that caused any of this or arranged any of this. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is doing this. But if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills for someone to be destroyed a certain way, inevitably this will happen. So the Pharaoh follows with his soldiers, and when the last soldier began to cross the shore, Musa alayhi salam saw that, so he attempted to do what? To hit the sea again with the stick. To what? To make it close on them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no. وَاتْرُكِ الْبَحْرَ رَهْوًا إِنَّهُمْ قَوْمٌ مُغْرَقُونَ. Leave the sea as is. You've done your job. You just keep moving. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed that they shall be drowned. And they were drowned. وَأَنْتُمْ تَنْظُرُونَ means that while you are, the Israelites, being addressed in this statement, while you are looking at them, you know, drowning, or while you're looking at one another, being amazed how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this miracle for you, you're walking across the sea, and behind you, the Pharaoh and his soldiers, 1 million men, are being drowned. This is the miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the deep conviction of those who trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now what follows that is even more amazing than the miracle. So they cross the sea, immediately they see a people that are worshipping idols. They see a people that are worshipping idols. What do they do? O Musa, اجعل لنا إلها كما لهم آلهة. Make an idol for us just like they have idols. It is something that is very difficult for the normal human mind with the right fitrah to accept, that after seeing such tremendous miracle in front of your eyes, and seeing is not like hearing. Seeing is not like hearing. The Prophet ﷺ, when in one of the hadith, when he was in a funeral, he told the Sahaba, I am eager to see my brothers. I am eager to see my brothers. They said, O Prophet of Allah, aren't we your brothers? He said, you are my friends. But my brothers are those who are going to come later, who are going to believe in me, who are going to believe in the revelation of the Quran, who are going to follow my sunnah, and they have not seen me. What does that tell us? Seeing is not like hearing. Seeing is not like hearing. And this is a tremendous honor for us. Inshallah, we are among those who the Prophet ﷺ said that we are his brothers, meaning that his brothers in the millah. وَإِذْ وَعَدْنَا مُوسَىٰ أَرْبَعِينَ لَيْلَةً ثُمَّ اتَّخَذْتُمُ الْعِجْلَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ وَأَنْتُمْ ظَالِمُونَ. And then we have a wa'd, an appointment, a time, and a place for this meeting to take place, 40 layla. Initially, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given Musa alayhi salam 30 days. And then he says, وَأَتْمَمْنَاهَا بِعَشْرٍ. And then we completed with 10. So that's 40 nights. I said days, but actually the ayah says nights. Why does the ayah say nights and not days? If you look at our sharia, if you look at our ibadat, how do we mark the lunar calendar? Is it by the sun or by the moon? It's by the moon. So we know that this is the beginning of the month when we see the hilal. This is the middle of the month when we see the badr, where the moon is complete. And then it begins to decrease, and then the Prophet ﷺ tells us, صُومُ لِرُؤْيَتِهِ وَأَفْطِرُ لِرُؤْيَتِهِ. Similarly, in all of our ibadat, be it hajj, or siyam, or calculating, you know, the 12 months that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed that in عِدَّةَ شُهُرِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ 12 شَهْرًا فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ, that the number of months in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are 12 months. The only way for us to calculate that is by way of the moon. And subhanAllah, the scholars point to us that the wisdom behind us following, or at least that's some of what we can grasp, following the lunar calendar. The lunar calendar is 11 days shorter than the solar calendar. Meaning that you're going to fast Ramadan in the summer, and you're going to fast it in the spring, and you're going to fast it in the fall, and you're going to fast it in the winter. And this is the case for every believer who is meant to live, you know, a reasonable length of time that you will fast Ramadan. In other words, you're harvesting acts of goodness in every part of the year, in every month in the year, in every season in the year. So this is part of the wisdom that we grasp on as to why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the lunar calendar 11 days shorter than the solar calendar. The only day that is referred to as a day in our calendar is Yawm Arafah, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said Al-Hajju Arafah. So that's calculated by the day and not by the night. But that's the only exception, you know, to this rule. وَاَدْوَعَدْنَا مُوسَىٰ أَرْبَعِينَ لَيْلَىٰ ثُمَّ اتَّخَذْتُمْ الْعِجْلَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ وَأَنْتُمْ ظَالِمُونَ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the appointment to Musa alayhi salam to go meet with him, what did the Israelites do? The Samiri, one of the Israelites, who saw when Jibreel alayhi salam came on a horse, and he says that he took like some of the traces of, we'll come to this story inshallah in details. Anyways, convinced the Israelites to do what? To gather the jewelry that they took from who? From the Pharaoh and his people. The way they've taken this jewelry is that when they used to provide the service for the elite part of the society, they used to steal from their jewelry. So when they left Egypt and crossed the sea, this jewelry stayed with them. So the scholars say, شؤم المعصية, the pessimism and the consequences and the implications of committing a sin followed them. So with that they stole, they created what? They created the calf. And they began to worship it. And this is something for us to take heed from. Sometimes when we go about our business, you know, during the day or at night, and all of a sudden, Bismillah, tawakkaltu ala Allah, la ilaha illallah, all of a sudden you have a car accident, wal-iyadhu billah. Or you fall and you break a finger or a leg or something like that. And you end up spending money on it, perhaps many, many folds of that which you've taken unjustly. Be it by way of deploying, you know, unethical means of doing business, be it by way of depriving the weak from that which is rightfully theirs, be it whatever the case might be, but the wise ones among us are those who try to establish the link. Why did this happen? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا أَصَابَ مِنْ مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ. Whatever calamity that touches us is because of what our hands have earned, because of what we've done. So the immediate thing the believer would say is, Astaghfirullah, Astaghfirullah. What did I do? And they begin to think, and they begin to evaluate their actions, and they begin to think back, did I hurt somebody? Did I cause injustice to somebody? Did I, curse somebody out? Did I inconvenience? So we begin to think that way in an effort to what? To purify ourselves. So this is an act of mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the surface, it's a consequence of the sin that we've committed. But we determine whether this consequence is going to be good or is going to be bad. In other words, sometimes we are successful by the grace and the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of performing a good deed. So we say Alhamdulillah. And that's why I see the scholars always say, Alhamdulillah alladhi la tatimmu as-salihatu illa bihamdi. All praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that righteous deeds are never successful, never perfected, except with the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So sometimes one would be successful in fasting the month of Ramadan and doing the qiyam and giving the sadaqah and this, this and that, and then at the end of Ramadan say, Alhamdulillah, I did very well. Or that's good, that they've attributed this success first and foremost to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But sometimes say, I've done perfect this Ramadan, as if they know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has accepted that from them. And then, as a consequence, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will leave them to themselves. In other words, you've done this on your own, be it. I'm gonna leave you alone, let's see what you can do. One person did this and came to one of the scholars and he said, this Ramadan, I did 10 out of 10. I've done the recitation, I've done the siyam, I've done the qiyam, I've done the you know, the nawafil, I've done the sadaqah, this, this and that, and he's just bragging about it, and the sheikh is looking at him. It's like, where's alhamdulillah? Where's bifadlillah? Where's with the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And then a few months later, he's coming back to the sheikh, and guess what he's saying? This is the person who did 10 out of 10 in Ramadan. He said, I cannot believe I've committed zina. He said, I cannot believe I've committed zina. Yani Shu'ayb alayhi salam, he said what? I am not, you know, I command you to do righteousness, and I'm not gonna do something different or opposite from what I command you. And then he says what? وَمَا تَوْفِيقِي إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. My success comes only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is a prophet. This is a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What about you and I? So always to remember, when we say, when we are successful to achieve an ibadah, perfect an ibadah, say alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. Realizing that I am not able to take even a single breath without the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when I take it, I'm not able to exhale except with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So going back to the story of the calf, as a result, as a consequence of them stealing this jewelry, right? It is no justification that the Pharaoh and his people have persecuted them for them to steal the jewelry. So as a result, they've used it to what? To commit a greater sin. The greatest sin of all, to commit shirk in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to create a calf and to say that this is the Lord of the Israelites and this is the Lord of Moses and Harun alayhim salam. ثم عفونا عنكم من بعد ذلك لعلكم تشكرون. Then we have forgiven you. عفو, we have forgiven you. After that, perhaps you will be grateful. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ أَتَيْنَا مُوسَى الْكِتَابَ وَالْفُرْقَانَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven them. But this forgiven has to have a kafara. You know, if we err, if we do something like that, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, أَتْبِعِ الْحَسَنَةَ السَّيِّئَةَ أَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُوهَا. Follow a sin with a hasana, you will wipe it out. If you swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then you find that what you swear on is not the right thing to do, then you need to do the kafara. And that's prescribed in the Quran. If you do something wrong in Hajj, you have to do kafara. In their case, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he had appointed Musa to a certain time and place, he descended upon him what? Al-kitaba wal-furqan. Al-kitab is the Torah. Al-furqan is that which divides and distinguishes between truth and falsehood. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ. Perhaps you will be guided. Perhaps you will be guided. So this type of guidance, after the forgiveness, is for you to do the right thing. We'll conclude with the next ayah, inshaAllah. وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ يَا قَوْمِ إِنَّكُمْ ظَلَمْتُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ بِاتِّخَادِكُمْ الْعِجْلَ فَتُوبُوا. Musa alayhi salam is telling his people, oh my people, you've caused tremendous injustice to yourselves by taking this calf as a deity aside from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now you need to make tawbah. What is the tawbah? Is what's the tawbah, as we mentioned, is sort of like to give up the sin, to resolve not to go back to it, and to regret it. But in their case, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who has given them life, right? He's telling them, for you to do your tawbah and for your tawbah to be accepted to you, just like I've given you life, فَتُوبُوا إِلَىٰ بَارِئِكُمْ, the one who created you and fashioned you, I need this life back. Give me the life that I've given you back. فَاقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, kill yourselves. Meaning that they've lined up into two different lines. And those who worshipped the calf on one side, and those who didn't on the other side. And the ones who didn't were commanded to kill those who did. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to lessen the impact of this kafara, he sent fog over them. Because here the father is killing the son, and the son is killing the father, and the brother is killing the brother, and so on and so forth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends the fog upon them to lessen, you know, the kafara and the impact of it upon them. And then it was reported that 70,000 of them were killed. And then Harun and Musa alayhi salam were supplicating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, O Allah, al-baqiyya, al-baqiyya, stay put on that which remained. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded favorably to their supplication. فَتُوبُوا إِلَىٰ بَارِكُمْ فَاقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Kill yourselves. This is a punishment in this dunya, but it's a kafara that will wipe out the sin in the hereafter. This is a kafara that will wipe out the sin in the hereafter. فَاقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ فَتُوبُوا إِلَى بَارِئِكُمْ فَاقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ عِنْدَ رَبِّكُمْ فَتَابَ عَلَيْكُمْ إِنَّهُ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. This is indeed best for you in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He would forgive you. إِنَّهُ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. He is the one who indeed accepts the tawbah. Ar-Rahim is the all forgiven. So when we make a tawbah, when we learn from these lessons, we need to understand what are the conditions of tawbah. And one, yes, one should feel bad about, you know, committing a sin. But sometimes committing that sin, look at what happens after it. Do you feel bad? Do you feel now you're more indebted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If that is the case, that's the right feeling. Now it's time to follow it with the right action. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who listen to the words of wisdom and follow the best of it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cause us to live as long as we live as Muslims and to die upon the shahada of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to educate us in the deen and to grant us the intellect and the faculty to follow whatever knowledge we gain. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-ridha'a ba'd al-qada', that we are pleased with the decree on Judgment Day and to look upon His beautiful face في غير ضراء مضرة ولا فتنة مضلة, without any harm or any hardship. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the company of the prophets, the messengers, the martyrs, and the righteous in paradise. أقول قولي هذا واستغفروه. اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعه بإحسان يوم الدين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.